Hello, welcome to my channel. My channel is all about soap making and other handmade products. You can find videos on bar and liquid soaps, wax tablets, and many other products. Please remember to like and subscribe to my channel for more videos and press the bell button so you don't miss out on any updates. Useful links and details are also provided in the description below. It's been a while and I'm so sorry that I've delayed this video for so long. This footage is an old footage of me making 100% olive oil soap along with the 100% coconut oil soap, where it makes it easier for me to mix the two soap pastes in different proportions for different purposes. Check out the video where I dilute my two soap pastes to get a thorough explanation. I have delayed this video so much because I felt the video was very long and repetitive and couldn't think of how to present it to you guys so it won't be as boring. So in this video, I've collected some of the common questions asked about liquid soap making in the previous comment sections, and I will address them in this video. The first step to making soap is to make the lye solution. Here I am mixing potassium hydroxide into water to make the lye solution. The first question is, can I use sodium hydroxide instead of potassium hydroxide? This question has been asked so many times, and I want to make it clear that in order to make liquid soap, you will need to use potassium hydroxide. Sodium hydroxide is used when you make solid bar soaps instead. So once all the lye has dissolved, with cold processed liquid soap, you just pour in the lye solution and turn on the stick blender. There are times that people use sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide together in liquid soaps. I see some soap makers use ratios of 8 to 2 or 9 to 1 potassium hydroxide to sodium hydroxide. There are mixed claims saying that using some sodium hydroxide will help to thicken the soap at the end, but some say it doesn't. I have not personally tried to make dual lye liquid soaps though, and may try it in the future to see what I think of it. I've only tried making a dual lye bar soap. The addition of potassium hydroxide made my 100% olive oil bar soap much less slimy, and I really liked it. You can go back to check out that video to get an idea of what I mean. So with cold processed liquid soap making, you just keep blending the mixture until it reaches a more solid texture. And because this time I'm using full olive oil, the process can take a long time. You can easily wear out your stick blender. So the strategy here is to mix for a few minutes and give it a break and come back to it and repeat the process. Another question I get asked a lot is, why is your recipe formula not in grams but in percentage? I personally do not like the idea of showing a soap formula in grams, mainly due to safety reasons. The first step of soap making should always be using a soap calculator to find out how much ingredients to weigh out. Some factors that affect how much ingredients to weigh out and are concerning include the purity of the potassium hydroxide, where it varies when you buy it from different manufacturers, the amount of liquid soap a person wants to make, the amount of superfat they prefer, and the units they like to measure it in. Soap making needs a certain point of accuracy to ensure safety when working with lye. So how to use the soap calculator? As you can see here is the soapy recipe page. To make liquid soap, you'll need to choose potassium hydroxide. Here is where you enter the purity. 90% is the recommended purity, but the only one I can get is 87%. And because I'm on a smaller batch weight, I will only use a total of 400 grams of oils this time. This is another 100% oil liquid soap that I've made along with the 100% coconut oil liquid soap I have made in my previous video. You can go back to the video where I've gone through the process of cold processed liquid soap making more thoroughly. With the amount of water in the recipe, I normally use 3 to 1 water to lye ratio. To make a slightly thicker soap, and for the soap to trace quicker, you can use a 2 to 1 ratio, and this might have been a better choice since olive oil soap takes forever to trace. Getting to step 4 of the superfat percentage, I would keep it low at 1% to prevent too much extra oils floating around in the soap to keep the soap clear, and that too much unsaponified oils will make it easier to spoil and become rancid. Step 5 with the percentage of the fragrance, I normally ignore as I add the fragrance when I dilute the soap paste. With adding additives, I have not much experience on that, but then I learn a lot of people do mix their lye with other liquids other than water to make more properties or adding salt. But because I haven't tried, I would not give too much comments. As I've mentioned, This video is another 100% oil liquid soap making. This time I'm using olive oil. And after all that, this section will tell you exactly how much oil, how much water, and potassium hydroxide to measure up. And also the total batch weight will be shown here too. Again, going through the soap calculator is very important in the process of soap making, and I believe all people should make the time to learn it through in order to make soap safely and have a safe product in the end. Another common question is that what is the difference between cold process method and hot process method when making liquid soap? The easy explanation of the difference between cold process and hot process is that hot process uses additional heat source to push through the process of saponification. And so, this means hot process would be a much faster process, but then the use of a heat source can lose some of the nutrients from the oils. There is a much obvious difference when making bar soaps, but the difference in liquid soaps is not that prominent in my opinion. I personally think, in general, liquid soap making takes a lot of time, and I find it easier to do cold process since you don't need to use a crock pot and all that. The liquid soap paste from cold process can be diluted right away for use as soon as it passes the SAP test, where you place a tiny bit of soap paste on your tongue and it doesn't SAP. This is different when making bar soaps, where it needs to cure for at least 4 weeks for it to be safely used on skin. However, I do like to sequester liquid soaps for a few weeks as it lathers better as time passes. Getting back to soap making, you can tell by now how much slower this 100% olive oil liquid soap is tracing compared to using 100% coconut oil. With cold processed liquid soap, as long as the mixture doesn't separate, you can actually leave it alone and time will do its job. But then I kept pushing to see whether I can reach the next stage. I did get the soap to a thick applesauce stage and eventually to a watery mashed potato stage. The process actually took too long and I had a date that night, so I left it wrapped up overnight and didn't come back to it until the next night. As you can see here, the soap mixture has separated where part of it looks done with it looking like Vaseline gel. So all you do here is to mix it up again with the stick blender. Only after a few pulses, the soap has already gone back to the mashed potato stage. I kept blending the mixture until I find it too hard to mix. Back to another common question. How do you thicken your soap? I personally don't thicken my soap because I find it unnecessary to thicken the soap if I use a foamer bottle to dispense the soap. In my opinion, this is what makes natural liquid soap distinct from commercial soaps. One way you can thicken your soap is to use a concentrated saline solution, but note that it won't work if your soap formula has a high percentage of coconut oil. Your liquid soap will also be thicker if you use thick oils like olive oil. You can also try to use less water to dilute your soap paste, but then that will make the dilution process a lot slower, and in my opinion, you just waste more soap that way. I stopped blending the soap once it got to this phase, and I covered it again to be checked out the next day. I also placed the soap into an insulated bag so to help it go through the process of saponification. Coming back to it the next day, the soap has turned into a very nice uniform paste looking like Vaseline gel. This is when you do the SAP test, placing the soap on the tip of the tongue, and if it doesn't SAP, it is ready for use. I'm also diluting a small amount to show you that it is a clear soap. Here is a question that is always asked. What preservatives can you use to preserve liquid soap? I don't use a preservative when I store my soap as a paste. Here you see I'm scooping the soap paste into a container, and I usually store the soap paste in the fridge and dilute it as I go. But once you dilute the soap with water, it has a higher risk of contamination and microbial growth. This is worth noting, especially if you will be selling your soap. The common preservatives used for liquid soap are Sutticide and Dermal Plus, which can be used in high pH like liquid soaps. You should definitely check out the exact percentage you should use from the manufacturer to add to your diluted soaps. Here is my finished liquid soap paste, ready to be used right away. This is how the soap lathers as I'm cleaning a container that I've made the soap paste in. Here you see the color difference between 100% olive oil soap and 100% coconut oil soap. Adjusting the proportions of two soap paste while diluting can give me different kinds of soap properties, like creating a new liquid soap every single time. Thank you so much for watching. Please give me a thumbs up if you liked the video and subscribe to the channel for more videos.